or live on the YouTube stream.
Awesome.
And let's see. Come on, stream. Waiting for it. Okay. Yeah, I have a double header today. I have you and I have Tony Skalepic today. So,
oh, cool.
Yeah, it's gonna be fun. All right, man. So I'm gonna go ahead and start the actual podcast, and here we go. Oh, cool. Real quick as well. If you see me looking at my phone or trying to go back and forth, I'm handling the online chat and also any questions that may be here. So I'm not trying to be rude. I'd like to. Yeah, I know. I just like to be
really
respectful.
Not that sensitive.
Okay, brother. Here we go. Hey there, everybody. Welcome this week. I have a special guest, as I do every week, I guess, because this is a show about people being on a podcast with guests that are artists. Anyways, I'm here today with a very awesome painter who's not only genius when it comes to luminance in dark situations, but just an all-around fucking great guy. The dude likes to joke around. The dude likes to just be cool and he looked at me and told me that I have a childish smile that has brought in his cold heart to a warm place for the first time in almost a decade. So without further ado, I bring you Cam Rackham.
Hello, everybody.
How's it going, brother?
I always thought I was such a serious guy.
Oh, you are. You totally are. I mean, I just said it for that one time, that one moment.
I'm fucking with you. I was watching David's podcast that you guys did. Mm-hmm. And I had seen it before, but I watched it again this morning. I forgot how serious it is. It's like so serious. Holocaust is so heavy. It's just so serious. I'm not that serious for being, you know. I take my art seriously, but Jesus.
I think really what it was with David, like David is a nice guy. He's genuinely cool. I think it's kind of the same way with like Blake. They have a message behind what they're doing, and I mean, even after like a few beers, which clearly David was having, you know, it's sharing your point of view. And I like that side of it. But I also think that people get misconstrued with the fact that they always perceive art having to have a voice about something rather than just something you enjoy doing, you know. And I genuinely like what they do. I liked what they said. And I think it was important for people that really go for that. But I mean, there's also other artists out there, I believe, including yourself, where you just want to have fun. You know, you just want to paint what you think's cool. And you know,
I wasn't trying to bash them.
Oh, no, not at all. Not at all.
It's some heavy subject matter. I love David's work. It's off the hook. Stunning. Stunning.
So how are you doing today, my friend?
My throat's a little shot. So if my voice starts cracking, I've been at a convention all weekend. And then the wife dragged me to a loud restaurant last night. And there's just like no rest for the wicked, you know. But I immediately feel like I'm not drinking enough. Since everybody else is drinking beer on the podcast, I'm gonna have to stop in a second and go get beer.
That's completely fine. I don't judge you. I'm having my very heavy dose, my double shot of green tea for my voice. My voice is shot as well. I party too hard. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
But you were at Musink, right?
Yes. Yes.
How was that?
Musink's amazing. Musink's really cool because it's like one of the few tattoo conventions that has the music component to it still, where people go for tattoos, they go for the bands, but they also go because there's like a cool hip community element to it too. It's become a really good place to show my type of artwork, and the tattoo community has been nothing but unbelievably cool to me for the last 10 years, 9 years. I feel like, you know, that Orange County, Southern California, and everybody that even makes that trip is definitely worth it. There's so many like dead conventions where, I mean, it's hard to meet other artists you like when they're in the middle of drilling some dude's back.
Right.
So it's got a little bit more of a friendlier vibe to it overall. Mm-hmm. No, overall.
Has it changed since Von D was, she was the one who first started, and now it's under Barker, right? Travis Barker, the one that runs it now?
Yeah, there was a long interim too between the two. But I feel like as big of entities as they are, it's not necessarily about them. I don't even think they maybe even wanted that to be, but it's really kind of about how that, how all the things that bleed into the tattoo community kind of seem to right there, which is really cool.
Yeah. Just because I remember the first year when it happened, I mean, everywhere from the bands to the artists to the cars, I mean, everything there was just dope because it was literally like everything like you said that embodied the tattoo community and the artist community together. The only reason I asked is because I haven't been there fucking years. And it looked, I saw through your Instagram, I was looking through many other tattoo artists and so forth, and it looked fun, man. It looked like a really great time. You had a really big booth set up, didn't you?
Yeah, yeah. I've been just kind of progressively doing better and better there, which is super fun. I'm kind of, you know, using it as a as an excuse not to do gallery stuff, which is a lot of fun. It's a little bit more friendlier of an atmosphere. The gallery can kind of turn into a gladiatorial arena at a certain point, and it's got a kind of a different intent behind it, you know, of showing art in a setting like that. Is it's a little bit less competitive, and it's a little bit more personable, I think, than the stuffiness of, you know, some business trying to stay open and has to throw a show every 30 days.
Right.
See, it's getting a little stale with the social media. You don't really need that as much as you used to in the past.
Well, I think we were talking about this with, actually it was with, Kate Zambrano. I don't know if you know her.
Yeah, I know her.
Yeah. She and I were talking a while back about how it's greatly changed the idea of how, you know, she prefers galleries, but you know, as far as
well, she said her boyfriend owns a gallery.
Yeah. Jason.
He also put on my last show last summer.
Jason's so awesome.
I'm fucking with you a little bit, but I love them. You know, they're awesome. They're awesome people.
Yeah. I love Jason. I love
next
Kate.
Time you talk to Nick, next time you talk to either of them, tell them to post more art and less bedrooms and dog selfies.
I'm pretty sure they're listening. No, but like she had made a point, I think, in one conversation we had about the whole idea that, you know, with social media these days, you can use it to an advantage, but it's different for people that are solely based around galleries versus the art artists and art community that's coming out of the whole idea of social media. You know, myself, I didn't start anywhere around galleries. There's no galleries where I'm from. You know, you right. did something, you took a photo right. of it, and you're like, hey, check it out. Cool. It's Batman, you know?
Yeah.
So let's go back a little bit on that. Where did you start? Where does young Cam Rackham, I imagine you as like a 4-year-old with a beard, a beautiful manly beard.
well, yeah, I was born with a beard.
All right.
So
sweet.
Let's start there.
I figured.
No, I don't know. I don't know. Is it all that interesting? Like, I, you know, when I started there wasn't kind of a place to show my artwork anywhere. And, I didn't know that was like even an option for me for so long. And then I actually had I was a director at a gallery for a minute in LA, and they seemed to be so exciting in the beginning. And then after a while it becomes work. And after a while it just becomes people are selling things to pay bills and whatever. And maybe I'm a little jaded to all that. But at the same time, I feel like a lot of the reasons people go into it are right, and the reasons that they stay, they kind of mutate in a way where there's some that are just these wonderful institutions that you know, work really hard. Some of them just like, you know, have to struggle to keep their doors open or fight to not get circumnavigated by social media too. Is would you rather hit up the artist for half the price or walk into their building? And it seems to happen more and more constantly where, you know, your question was nowhere near that.
It's okay. No, it's good.
I started doing illustration stuff in like the music industry, where it's kind of where I cut my teeth. And I worked for like the largest rock clothing producer in the world, making, you know, just quick mods of stuff. They want like 10 to 25 designs a week. It's a lot to draw. You know, it's a brutal task. But it kind of learned, I kind of, you know, learned a lot of things the hard way doing that. So my idols weren't like, you know, these modern art types that were real big when I was young. You know, I think a lot of too is online likes to shit on the modern artists all day.
Oh yeah,
the contemporaries.
Yeah, very much.
Which is fun, and I know and the tattoo community loves to look at it and go, "What a bunch of bullshit!" But and I totally agree in a million ways, and then in a million ways I don't too. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't have the restraint to put a big cube in a room and open the door and say, "Here's my works."
You know, I call it sphere.
Right, call it sphere, you know, but I think it takes like a lot of guts to wear your heart that far out on your sleeve or a shitload of narcissism. But either way, like, I don't have that capacity, so I'm in awe by it.
Right.
I'm very impressed where you can just, you know, write something in neon light and that's it. And it's like, wow. Good for you. Like,
did you ever hear about the Blank Gallery, the Blank Canvas show that was put on by James Franco?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah, so for anyone that doesn't know what that is, James Franco actually put on a gallery show where he had empty frames and literally nothing on some of the walls and told people to imagine their ideal setting. They would give you
what a dickhead.
And there was a woman who bought a painting for $10,000. Okay, 10 grand. Yeah. Had it delivered, and because the frame had nothing to support it as such a canvas inside or anything, it was just the frame. The movers accidentally broke it, and she was suing. And the movers were like, "Well, what happened to the painting?" She was like, "Oh my god, you got to imagine the painting. It was there. It's..." Oh my god. Like I said, I don't want to shit on anyone's creativity ever. But there's some time where you look at it and it's just like, like you said, sometimes it takes a little bit more to be that creative. I'm doing air quotes right here.
Right, right. Well, I mean, there's definitely a big division. It's like a chasm of a division where there's people who will, you know, kill themselves for 4 years putting together a collection of stuff. And there's people who will hire out a couple of guys, and within a month they've slapped together some, you know, contemporary nonsense, and or what can be viewed as nonsense, and like walk away from it like it's whatever. I don't know. I think it puts people off to the art world in general. When you tell people that you're an artist, they immediately assume that you're full of shit. And then you have to like carry your phone around with you, like your portfolio. Like, no. Honestly, I'm not full of shit. Look, that's okay. Do you like that? Become this like desperate soul, or it's just, you know, it's almost easier when people ask what I do. If I'm a tattoo artist, like, fuck it. Like,
well,
at least that's so cool. Like,
it's true though. I mean, how many people actually read the posts? You know, I've had this conversation with World of Pencils. I've had this conversation with other people of that. When you're promoting something, 9 times out of 10, especially if you're a very well-followed artist, nobody ever reads the caption, even if you're just trying to be like, hey, check this out. It's maybe like a good, you know, 10% reads it. But I mean, I'm always very interested in how you hear some artists that go and they go into a person's page and they're like, oh my God, Cam, this painting's beautiful. Please check my work and follow. And you're just
right,
like,
right.
And then you're like, oh, okay, I see right. Where this is going. And then you, every once in a while, you'll be like, okay, you know what? I'll check it. And then they have a private page because they want you to add them. And it's like, all right, if you're doing it for the quote unquote love of art, then why do you have a private page? You know,
honestly, every person that tells me like, check out my work, I check it out.
Yeah.
I might not like it, yeah. But at the same time, I'll check it out. You know what gets me is when they go, check out my work. And I go, and it's like, someone's breakfast, their kids, 20 selfies, and somewhere like on image 40, there's some like hand turkey of a sketch. And it's like, dude, come on. Like,
the hand turkey.
You just wanted my attention. It's fine. It's fine. But I will check out your work. So fucking let's see it. I love it.
So when you started off in the music designing industry for the clothing, correctly? Or correct?
Sort of.
When you started off doing that, what kind of got you into that area? Because I'm assuming this is way before the whole social media movement that we have now, right?
Yeah, that's a pre-MySpace thing. I mean, that's like how far back that is. you know, I had a couple of buddies. We all grew up on the same street, in like the really early 90s, and they had this little cool hardcore punk band, and it's like your best friend and your neighbor that lives next door, and he was like, "Hey, can you draw something?" And it's like, "Yeah, hey, do you want to paint us something? We have a little record coming out." Yeah, all of a sudden their band got some major record deal, and they became huge, almost in like a overnight capacity. And I had a whole bunch of artwork on it, which you would think would be good, but I'm, some amateur that was just making stick figures for buddies. And, it was never necessarily intended to be like what I was initially going to do. It was just something that we wanted to, help your friends sell some records and grow their business. And then all of a sudden, I had Googled my name and I had a ton of negative response to work that was coming out way before I was ready to even release anything in kind of a public capacity. And they had bashed the shit out of me. Deservedly so, too. 10 million people see something and the artwork sucks. It's when it sucks, it sucks. And it kind of motivated me to go to school, motivated me to work harder, it motivated me to be better. And I just spent the next 15, 16 years after that trying to improve my ability,
I didn't, excuse me, I think that a lot of the artwork, especially growing up around punk bands, ska bands, you'd see the flyers, And I had two or three friends that the same thing, hey man, we have the show coming up, backyard show. We just need something real quick. And you'd see the ferocity in some of these artists that would sketch out an entire set list. And
Oh my God.
what's your band's name? We're the Bootleg Reagans, or Death by Cheesecake. And we want our font like this and da 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 da. And they would go off and you'd see these amazing little posters come out. And it's kind of crazy because most of those kids I knew that did that for backyard shows, the ones that did carry on an art career managed themselves a lot better in a pressure setting. When you're actually having to work for a company and you have deadlines and so forth, they're used to having to get things done right away versus just kind of
Oh, I
jumping
can't even
into
tell you how bad like a record deadline is. Like
it.
I can't. Because it's like you'll get a phone call on Thursday and by Monday morning they need copy to print because they're going to press, 100,000 copies. So you better, get ready not to sleep because you got to paint the thing, shoot the thing, Photoshop the thing and get it in there. Like, you go, it's like there have been some deadlines where it's like I need an album cover and I got 72 hours. And it's one thing when it's somebody you don't know, but after doing music stuff for a while, you become friends with, a million people and you never want to let anybody down.
Right.
And it turns into like, yeah, I can do it. I'll never forgive you, but I can do it. And then of course, musicians are fucking assholes, send you a photo from the bar of them having a good time because they know you're killing yourself.
Oh yeah. Oh bro, wish you were here. Just let me know next
Yeah,
time I'll
like
buy you
how's
a
it
beer.
going?
Yeah. How's it going, bro? We'll buy you a
Yeah.
beer. Make sure it's draft only.
I love it. I'm complaining, but like, and I love to complain, but I love it. Like,
Do you remember an album cover that you did that was like just either it was a pain in the ass or something that you'll just never forget in general?
oh, I'll never like any of them I ever did. I'm never satisfied when it's a music thing because, like, it's one of those things where it's like when you're doing a commission for one person, I'm at this wonderful point in my career where, there's a like a people kind of understand my style and abilities and things like that. So people are seem to be pleased 99% of the time, which is so wonderful. I can't even say, especially after hacking it out with musicians for so long. But you get into like, there's so many different hands in that fire. It's not just five band members that are gonna have a say. There's a manager, there's a production, the guy. How are they going to turn your album cover into a t-shirt? Well, I didn't design it for a t-shirt. I designed it to be an album cover. Well, how are we going to turn it into a backdrop? Well, it's not supposed to be a fucking backdrop. supposed to be an album cover. Well, how are we going to put it on 900 different social media platforms? It's like, Jesus Christ. Like, what'd you ask me to make you? It's like, at a certain point, you just want to make a Nike swoosh and say, thanks, dude. Have a great day.
There's a great story about something like that. So the during the Descendants documentary, they mentioned the artist who came up with Milo, the original drawing. And they're talking about how, you know, who he is, what he's done. And if you look a little bit more into him, the guy has this really interesting idea when he says, you know, you look at Alice Cooper, Alice in Chains, you look at all these different bands from way back in the day, and you had people like Drew Struzan, you had Arimento, I can't say his last name. Anyways, a lot of the old cover artists, and they would do these beautiful covers that are iconic. You know, they were hand-painted, hand-sketched, the whole thing. And then you have him, and he's like, I just drew a stick figure, basically, you know? and he goes, the pressure of trying to find something that's that iconic in simplicity sometimes doesn't even come from talent.
So much harder.
Yeah, it's so much harder. He goes, it's so much harder. He goes, but it doesn't usually come from talent. It comes from dumb luck. And it's so true.
Well, yeah, yeah.
So with the whole thing of like working for a distributor like that, do you feel that also has had an influence on your opinion on galleries? Because galleries versus the workflow you're used to is kind of contradictive.
Well, I've kind of stopped doing the music stuff like 5-6 years ago. There's only a couple of friends I still work for now, like a handful. And part of that is the money's all gone. People download everything, and it's hard for record labels to justify budgets for whatever social media they're kicking out. So it's like the dinosaurs have all died, you know, which is sad. I don't even know how kids listen to new music anymore. Like, I don't even think they like music. It's crazy to me. the MySpace era, everybody with the garage had a band in that garage.
Oh yeah.
And that's now gone. That's a horrible thing. Like, there's a few bands that survived it, you know, like Paramore was one of those bands that survived that era of like, you know, we're a small internet entity and bam, now we're like a big deal, which is cool. But I think when everything shifted to Facebook, there is this wreckage that got lost, and there was so much cool stuff out there and so much stuff with like so much potential out there. Mm-hmm. And one of those things working with musicians is fun is there's such auditory creative types is that doing a visual for it, it's a whole other element that comes into it. I can't think of that Master of Puppets album without seeing that album cover.
Right.
It's an impossibility to me, you know. And I think the two marry each other like really well, in a lot of ways. And I think so much of that is lost. So much of that is lost.
Well, I mean, you're right. You're completely right. I remember 2003, I was sitting in my buddy's, bedroom, and we're sitting there, and he's, you know, we have Earthlink or some stupid ass, you know, internet connection where they promised us one page for 3 minutes, and you're like, sweet bro,
right.
Boobs anytime right. Now. but we were there, and I forget the name of the website it was on, but it was like a version of SoundCloud, just a little bit older. But bands would sign up to it, and you could listen to independent bands, you know, that were trying to push their own thing. And he showed me this one band, and he's like, dude, these guys are from the UK. They're pretty dope. They couldn't even get past 1,000 downloads.
Yeah.
And you'd see them, but their artwork for some of their T-shirts was, very, you know, DIY. And very cool. I liked it. And come to find out, like 2 years later, we saw them on TV. I was like, isn't that them? And it was Block Party. And it was like a very, and I was like, wow, dude, that's so crazy. Like, I think I had my first hipster moment where I was like, I listened to them before they were cool.
Way before
they were cool, bro. You don't even know. I was one of the first 1,000 downloads. Did you buy their EP? Oh, no. One of those douchebags.
You know, it's funny because, like, I think really, like, these whole micro genres of music were lost in that technology shift. And as much as it sounds like I'm complaining about it, it's been fantastic for me is everything's become so much more visual.
Mm-hmm.
So as an artist, I'm able to have a much more mobile, accessible career, which is super cool. Like, with things like Instagram, I remember I had an Android phone at the time, and, before you could only get it on a iPhone when they were testing it. And I remember I was waiting for the day, for the hour that I was able to get a new platform that would finally support me, you know, that I could get on and finally feel like I had a home, you know, outside of Facebook. I never really fell in love with the Facebook format. It was too much like, it's too much of verbal diarrhea that keeps happening on it, where it's like, dude, I love you, but I really don't give a shit.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. And it's tough when it's like your aunt, right? Were, like, you know, not that you ever do that, Aunt Carolyn. I love you. She doesn't. Just an example.
No, but you, so, I mean, do you think that you made a very good point. Do you think that that has an influence as well? I mean, going back a little bit, you're saying that when, you know, as music transitioned, it's become much more visual. People look today, I mean, it's almost like the 80s again, where you have a lot of dance parties, you have so forth, neon lights, the whole thing going on. But people rely a lot more on visuals than they did back in the 90s, 80s, 70s. So as an artist, you have to match those visuals. You know, you have to, have to accentuate that. With that being said, that ties into the whole Instagram, Facebook, the whole shebang-a-bang. Do you think that that's pushed artists in a a little bit harder, because now you're not just competing. Like beforehand, you'd have to go to a gallery, you'd have to buy books,
right,
you know, to see other people's work. Now you just click and you're literally a half a world away looking at someone doing something remotely close.
No, I don't think it pushes. I think it pushes everybody fucking lazy.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody, all the musicians, it's so much easier to grab a piece of digital. That there's like guys that are super talented have these like volumes of digital stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And that one doesn't work. How's the next one? That one doesn't work. How's the next one? That one doesn't work. How's the next one? And there was an era where I remember the t-shirts coming out of like the larger distributor, the same ones were going for like five different bands and they just interchange them to see who likes what. And yeah, it was all blood splatter and bullets, blood splatter and skulls and bullets. And it's just like everything gets super stale, super saturated because the money doesn't exist anymore, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I think as far as being an artist, if you're doing music, you have to do digital. Like there's so many projects that wouldn't work with me because I wouldn't do, you know, these huge digital things. It's just not my thing. I'm just not that good at it. Or I didn't want to get that good at it and learn those techniques because I'm a painter and I kind of missed that whole 80s era of illustration that I think would have been super rad doing prog rock albums.
Yeah. Well, I mean, they're making a comeback, especially with the whole vinyl movement. Everybody was associating it with being a hipster thing. But I mean, if you truly love music, nothing's better than a vinyl. I mean, I've learned that because of my girlfriend. Right. My girlfriend has brought me back. I've been a musician almost 30 years and I literally forgot about just listening to an album, not going through my phone and a playlist with the same 15 songs, like literally sitting there and enjoying it. And Josh Bodwell, a tattoo artist and awesome artist as well, he just did the Dark Crystal supporting artwork, you know, and cool. did it digitally. But like his thing was that he had always looked up, you know, Struzan, Azario and all these other dudes. And now as vinyl's right. coming back, they're looking for artists to recreate these iconic illustrative albums, you know? And so would that be something to be interested in if it was presented to you, even in a physical format?
Oh, I've done a bunch of them.
Well, okay.
You know what rules about it is that when people buy it,
mm-hmm.
they buy it to stick it on their wall.
Mm-hmm.
They get if it's like their favorite band, they go get an album record frame. And all of a sudden, not only do they get the record, but they get a piece of wall art too, mm-hmm. which is very cool.
Well, no, it's true. My girlfriend bought this box set of the same, like the vinyl, same four times. And this is when I first was learning about vinyl. I was like, why? It's the same thing. And she opened them up and the illustrations and the vinyl itself. I was like, whoa, it was outstanding. Cause I was like, it's like looking at an old movie poster. It's like looking at a storybook again. And it just gets too excited.
I was in London last month and they had vinyl shops everywhere where I was and people in them and people buying stuff, you know, and even in SoCal here, I can think of two, maybe, you know, that, and it's a lot of secondhand, like it's, you know, it's just not, It's not part of this fabric anymore. People don't listen to records, like the whole record anymore. They just like pull out Spotify, stream what they like, you know, and go on. And, you know, it's interesting too, is the way people perceive music, like Coachella, which is the biggest festival now, in my opinion. I don't know, maybe there's a bigger one, but in the United States, I feel like Coachella is one of the biggest.
Right.
I think that's fair to say. And the way they do the lineup, it's always been kind of all over the place, but that's how people listen to music on their, I don't want to say iPod, but that's how they listen to it now. It's like one song from an electronic band, one song from a pop star, one song from, you know, a classic rock thing. And that's how kind of their playlist rolls. That's how their set lineup goes. And none of it seems to make any sense anymore to me, because I'm a dinosaur, right? It's like, oh, well, we're going to the punk rock festival. Hope all these bands are very punk rock. That looks like a ska band. I don't want to hear that. You know, and the puritanical part of music is totally gone, where I want to hear everything.
Right.
Because I listen to everything like that now, you know.
No, you're completely right. The idea of like what going to Coachella and on all those ideas, as a musician, I would always be the person where I'd have to sit behind the drummer. You know, drums, percussion, anything, yeah. I would have to study them because I was genuinely interested in what they were doing. I loved to hear the music. I loved to hear what they were doing. And it was my way of trying to learn something from anything I could possibly get my hands on. Art, I think, ties into that because, like you said, now it's this giant playlist from these crazy, you know, what stage are you going to? Well, people literally map out, like Disneyland, yeah, yeah, where they're going rather than just, yeah, watching a band. And Instagram has been that way. I mean, granted, Instagram is what you're in a world of pencils on, where you're at, where I'm at. And, you know, it is a viable tool. But, you know, you kind of start, I think the more mature, I should say, you get, I don't want to say older because it has nothing to do with age. But the more mature you get as an artist or as a musician or whatever, you kind of regress back to old things. Like for me, rather than going on Instagram, I can go all day and just sit there like a fat, you know, fuck and be like, oh, that's awesome. Sweet.
No, but, dude, it's an old person thing.
Oh, no, yeah. But, oh,
everybody remembers how great it was back in the day. I was on tour of Slayer last year, and it was so funny because there were like these deathcore bands, like, which it wasn't hardcore to me. It was like these bands where like just sounded like dogs barking and broken glass to me.
You mean their names? You mean their names are like, they're like broken sticks that are all stuck together?
No. That wasn't logo. Like some classy black metal. This was like it was like these impending doom type deathcore bands. Not as good as impending doom. But Slayer's the big headliner. So Dad would show up and his emo looking kid would show up, and there was this huge division where the kids were doing their crab slam dancing, the crab walk dancing, and the dads were out moshing. And it was funny where you would hear dads going, hurry up, you know, Slayer's about to start. And his kid would look at him and go, no one wants to listen to your classic rock, Dad, like straight out, you know. Wow. And I was thinking about like, holy shit, that record did come out like 1983 or something.
Mm-hmm.
30 plus year old band, like, oh, I didn't, holy crap, I'm into classic rock now, I guess.
it's true though. We get stuck in this time frame of where, you know, I'm still thinking the 90s is 10 years ago. I'm still thinking the 80s is like 15 right, years ago. Yeah. You know, yeah. And I'm like, oh, 80 something. Oh yeah, that was just the other day. But you make a good point, because now, rather than going through Instagram, I make it a point. I'm either I physically, when I can, try to go to a bookstore, or I go on Amazon, you know, or right, record shops. My music and my art has to come in a physical format, you know, that I like to collect and I like to open books. My biggest thing are like compilation books. If I were to buy a book that has a bunch of paintings in them and one of your paintings is in there and I've never heard of you, that's a great way for me to see different artists that I may like, you know, and kind of the idea of where, I don't know, I feel like a lot of stuff is getting lost due to technology, even though I'm a proprietor of technology, but very much the old fart is coming out, because I'm just like, well, back in my day, you know, we used to do this, you know? So,
yeah, you know,
so going to your,
the accessibility of stuff is fantastic. I love it.
Oh yeah.
You know? But, and you're exposed to so much more so fast, which is unbelievable, you know. And you can expose your work to so many more people, which is cool.
So where did you?
There's some love lost.
Oh, of course. Sure. I was about to ask, like, where do you feel? Where do you feel it lies? Like, you know, you said the love lost. Like, do you feel that it's a good thing?
So like when I'm trying to show my work, and every person on the planet's painting is always better in real life, because it wasn't made on a 2-inch screen on their phone. Maybe it was, I don't know. But there's something lost in that distance where you stand and look at it. There's a scale. There's a three-dimensional quality to things. Things tend to flatten out really hard on a phone or a tablet. Mm-hmm. And what you have to do now, which sucks, is you got to be as global as you can be, or as mobile as you can be, is I find myself trying to show my work back and forth, you know, across large population centers where I think more people would have an opportunity to see it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it gets to be difficult to ship or drive, you know, LA to New York with 20 paintings in the back of your truck. It's a trek, you know.
Yeah.
Or pay a service to do it and fly out and receive it and hang it. Like, it's a whole thing. And the journey is part of the experience of showing her work now. It's gotten to be more difficult. I mean, meeting with some galleries where it's like, well, despite showing my work in your building, where are you gonna take me?
Right.
You know? And it's like, it's got a lot more like, what can you do for me? Which sucks for them because, you know, they're trying to do their job too, which is becoming more and more difficult by the second.
Most artists don't even realize that you do have to have a very clear business mindset after a while. You know, if you do want to do this for a living, you have to have some kind of idea. Like you said, there is a gallery. I think it was in Australia. A few sculptors had posted about it, happened last year, I believe, but they had over 30 artists that had submitted to them. I wish I could remember what it was. But they had submitted from all over the world, like real pieces. They had taken a year to put this event together, and the person just ran off with everything, you know, and took all the work from everybody, and nobody can find this person. And
wow, each, that's horrible.
It's horrible, but at the same time, it's like, you know, you have to be aware if you're going places, if you're doing things, even with your art, you're going to have to find people that are going to look out for your best interest. You're going to have to find ways to not only market yourself, but to carry your work, because traveling from Texas to New York to California, that's not easy when you have to physically show paintings and ship and do this and do that and pack, and it gets daunting.
Yeah, it loses a lot of the fun. You know, you start wrapping things and you think, oh God, man, I'd rather just sit in the studio and paint. But showing it, and it's hard too, because like a lot of artists, they're so locked up in the studio for so long, working so hard, chasing their careers, is that by the time they get out and get anywhere, it's like they've been uncaged for the weekend. If you go to like a big group show, it's like, you know, a couple hundred people, and none of them know how to act because they're all painters. They've been locked in their studio the last 6 months. So it's hard to find a balance a lot of the time. You know, it's hard to find a balance a lot of the time.
So after you were doing the whole clothing and the distribution stuff, where did you go from there?
Gosh, I don't know if I even remember. I had a funny story. Is I really wanted to show my work in New York, and I had a good buddy who was showing a painting of mine in Philadelphia. All your buddy Nestor, shout out. What's up, fatty?
Hey, how's it going?
It's not you. And which was super sweet of him. He put a lot of faith. And I'm like, I'm one of those assholes that's super demanding. I hate sharing walls with other artists. And I know it sounds super shitty, but it's like I didn't design it for other things to be around it. That's mm-hmm. kind of the context, is that like it wasn't made to be in a comparison context. It was made to be on its own thing. If I wanted something near it, I would have made other things to go near it. Mm-hmm. That sounds weird, but so group shows tend to become difficult for me, and I end up having these huge demands, which sorry, all gallery people that deal with me. I apologize. sincerely. especially Phil. Phil, I'm sorry. I was super broke when I was showing this thing in Philadelphia, and I had a couple of friends with me, and we had like a one of the early tablets, and it was like, I really want to go to New York. You really want to try to meet some people face to face and make some actual face to face contacts. Galleries, especially if you've worked at one for a minute, they get submissions sent to them daily. There's a big pile, and they open up the pile and they pretty much throw it in the trash. And I've seen them do it, and it's like the most fucked up. Like, if you haven't printed on a book, they really don't give a fuck about you anymore. They know who they want and what they're looking for, and if you're real small, it's real difficult to get any kind of traction. So we paid some dude $20 to drive us from Philly to New York in his car with like 900,000 miles on it. Nine of us packed into it, and he just dropped us off in city center, and we decided we were gonna figure it out how to get back to LA from there, which was super cool. But we, you know, a couple of us walked into a gallery with an iPad, and I was like, we came from, you know, look, we're living in the streets at this point. Like, we came from California. This is our work. Please show us. and that was that. And sometimes the sacrifice and the struggle is worth it. It depends how much you are willing to sacrifice. Those tend to be my favorite artists, is the ones that have really, like, you know, thrown away all their personal relationships, obliterated their finances, and really put everything they had on the line. Because that's what I identify with is, yeah, like, fuck, dude, I did it. I lived in a shitty, tiny place and ate ramen for years, like, until I figured it out. And it wasn't like the world's fault. It was my fault. Like, yeah, I wasn't good enough to make it work out. You think you're fighting the world, and you're really fighting yourself constantly.
I definitely respect the shit out of that, because, you know, same thing here, man. When I first moved down to LA years ago, when I was down there, you know, just to get a job, I stayed on the street for 2 weeks, you know, just because the people had told me, like, hey, where you living? I was homeless for years, you know, living in the back of a van, lost a van. And then they're like, hey, if you can come down to LA, man, we will talk to you if you want to work in this tattoo shop. I lied to them, and I was like, yeah, I live down the street. So I took the last $60 I had, went from Fresno, California, down to Los Angeles on a Greyhound, which took way too long. I got there, and they're like, oh, by the way, the boss won't be here for 2 weeks. He's in China. They had a tattooing. So I was like, they're like, oh, yeah, just come back in 2 weeks. You live down the street, right? And I was like, all right. So I literally had my moment in the sun living in West Hollywood for 2 weeks on the streets that's going around. And like you said, you know, the entire time you have it in your mind, it's like, I want to do this. I want to learn how to paint. I want to learn how to tattoo. If I'm going to do this, I'm going to do it. And it's no one else's fault if I fail, but my own. But if I don't make it, then I'll find another way to go.
Yeah, no, if you want it bad enough, you have to kill yourself to get it. That's just kind of my opinion. I hate saying this because people
take it the wrong way.
Call bullshit, but I don't believe in like natural ability. I feel like it's all like kind of a process of figuring it out. And some people it's easier for them to figure out than others. And there's an edge that you want to push and push and push constantly with yourself, you know, to be able to do those things. It's one of the, you know, it's really cool with the internet these days, where the realism has really exploded across the internet. Mm-hmm. It's good. It's a good and a bad thing. I think it's more of a good thing, is people's general taste is, you know, something that they can tell was made by another person, and they can't exactly figure out how.
Right.
And there's something super magical to that, from like a Lascaux cave painting to, you know, a modern pencil drawing.
I feel that you're right, because the funny thing too is that, like, you'll see BuzzFeed, you know, BuzzFeed pops up on Facebook, and, you know, somebody's like, oh my God, there's a pen. I forget who it was. And like I said, not shitting on the dude, but the guy's some Italian artist. Dude does beautiful work in Faber-Castell pencils. Does beautiful work.
Yeah.
Portraiture work, so forth, so on. But there were, you know, they're like one of very few artists that knows how to bring portraits to life. And you're looking at it, and you're like, it's not the greatest, but it's definitely impressive. Don't get me wrong. Like I said, I don't want to make it seem like I shit on the guy, but you're reading the comments and I'm just curious to see how people think. And all these people who have no idea, they're like, how come this guy isn't the Da Vinci of our time? You know, some of the guys are sucre bleu. He's mucho mezin. And it's interesting because you're right. It has opened it up. With your work, because I know I came across your paintings probably like a year and a half ago, 2 years ago. And I saw just the way you were like bringing a very focused luminance to one of your skull paintings. And I was like, God damn, that's really nice, because it was simple, but it was unique. And to me, I'm one of those dudes where I come from a very interested background in, you know, movie posters and cover art.
Yeah.
So, you know, in most cover art in the 80s, there was
like a normal person.
It's so like, as you look at it, you know, there's this giant story being told. And I've always had the hardest time with art personally to be like, how can you captivate someone's imagination in one little setting? And right then and there I saw your stuff. So looking at that, it was a great inspiration, because I started doing skull studies. I started doing light studies, because it was about bringing this giant idea into this small focused little realm and being like, oh, okay, maybe I should work on this. Maybe I should focus on that. You know, how did you get to where you're at? I don't want to say currently right now, but what started influencing you into painting the candle lighting, the skulls, the everything?
I like hanging out in museums. And when I go on vacation, I like strategize whose art is where that I'm going to go see. the contemporary modern stuff was never – like, I grew up in a family that hated it, which sucks, because I should have been – bred to hate it, but I kind of was. So there's always a part of me that like pushes back against that. And my version of a well-done master painting was this garishly framed, you know, dimly lit chiaroscuro Caravaggio. It's like, and a lot of people feel that way. There's something about that will always be kind of like my first love. But working less 5-6 years, I'm trying to get the light to kind of bend more, so to speak. Mm-hmm. Is how far can I push those kind of refracted and ambient light kind of and reflection and those type of ideals. And I want to kind of not overdo it, instead of, you know, putting a 10 million objects on a table and trying to make a Venetas. There's a lobster, there's a, you know, a sword, a skull, a can. Like there's something to that that's very cool, but it feels a bit decorative. Or it can feel decorative really fast, where my journey was a little bit more, how can I push the light harder the other way? And, you know, I think people kind of will always identify with certain subject matter, like nude women, or nude men too, like human skull, things like that. Different contexts of those seem to strike a chord with not just me, but people in general.
Do you, when you're taking your reference photos, do you paint from live, or do you do you paint from a live model, or do you paint from photo reference?
Okay, so I was taught to paint from live subject matter. Mm-hmm. The problem is if you have an extremely darkly lit room with one tiny candle in it, you better take a photo, or else you're painting in the straight up dark.
Right.
And I've got some buddies like Trevor Frederick and Kevin Llewellyn, who they love painting in almost or drawing in pitch blackness.
Oh, especially Kevin. Kevin loves his dungeon. Him and Chase Smith, them in that little, and boy, his place. Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, and then, you know, and if you talk to him, he's like, oh, I painted way even darker than this. And it's like, are you crazy? But that's just kind of not how my eyes and my brain work. Mm-hmm. I like it light when I'm working on a dark painting, and dark when I'm working on subject matter.
So when you shoot, do you shoot just at like a very wide aperture? or a high ISO. So like when you're taking your photo, you're trying to keep it to where it's, I'm sorry, not a high aperture, but you're trying to keep it to where the minimalist amount of light that you're preferring is just showing. So you, like you said, when you're trying to bend light, you're capturing like as natural as possible.
This sounds like technical questions for your other podcast. shifting roles, dude.
I know. I'm sorry. I'm trying.
Everybody that wanted to hear about band shit, they're gonna rut. Yeah, get off YouTube. Yeah. Just close it. Just delete me.
That's on the other podcast, Fat Boy.
Unsubscribe.
That's on the other podcast, Fat Boy.
Right. No. So like, it actually kind of depends, mm-hmm. right? Sometimes I want like a quick lens open for just 1 second, mm-hmm. you know, depending upon how much light I'm pushing at the subject. Sometimes I need to let it sit there for 30 seconds to try to absorb as much as I can. I don't really have a necessarily like a structured way I do it every time, because looking for so many different angles and shapes and moods. And I also want to try to get a feeling and a sense. I think there's a really big problem with online art, or art that's viewed online, is mm-hmm. that people are just trying to get as many likes and as much traction as they can, instead of making the best image that they can, mm-hmm. because you're not actually making an image, you know, in a tiny little square. You're actually making it for something, for another context.
Right.
And it's losing a lot of soul. I think a lot of the times my personal philosophy is all creative endeavors should be made out of two pillars of intent and content. If your content sucks, it almost doesn't matter what your intent is. If your intentions are good and your context is good, then you could have something, you have the chemistry to make something wonderful.
Of course.
And like a lot of times it's just like, oh, I want to smash this realism thing and make it more and more real. And I think using a little bit of restraint, pulling back a little bit further, and just kind of using more of a director's eye of, this is the important part, this is the less important part, you know? Mm. You look at somebody like we were talking about Llewellyn or Barber's work, is there's a lot of the important parts are grasped, and the rest kind of is almost an impressionist drop off the back.
Yeah.
And the way your eye reads it, it's like directing. Look at this first, absorb that later, you know? And you kind of want to sort those details out. The problem with the photography is you flatten it, and then you make an image of it, and then you flatten it again when you shoot it again to shoot it. So you have to be really careful with some of that stuff. And I think that comes with like time and experience. I think there's a problem of making things look too 3D.
Right.
When you're doing realism, there's a tendency to try to make it look constantly like a photo, and it can very fast, especially if you took it from a fucking photo. So I'm wrestling with that myself too, you know, like, sometimes I don't want it to look so real. Well, I want it to let go.
Like you said, you know, like Barber, Llewellyn, Dobsky, Aaron Engel, I believe his name is, or Engel.
Oh, yeah.
You know, like
Nagel.
And Nagel, thank you. You look at a lot of work. you look at a lot of work, I mean, yours included. And I think the best way I've ever heard it described is the fact that, you know, it's peripheral. You know, the only reason why we ever perceive what the real world is that 30% of our vision is directed towards something. Everything around it is blurred out. So when people have the context, especially like you say, you see a lot of these artists who are jumping onto Instagram and they're like, look at how real I can make it. You could literally copy it, like, you know, shade for shade, you know, pixel for pixel, all the way down to the just minute detail on something, and it just doesn't look real anymore. There's no life to it. And people look at Barber's work, people look at yours, people look at Cheatham's work, and they're like, how do you just get, you know, those that rawness, how do you just bring it out? It's like, well, you know, it's like a peripheral. You're just kind of focusing, like you said, on something, and the rest of it, you're, you know, well, I'll do this, I'll do that. David Chaffetz, love that dude to death, sweetheart and an amazing artist. That guy is kind of the same thing, like you said. You know, when he focuses, he does these still lifes, and you don't want this thing to be too busy. You don't want it to be too, you know, unfocused. And he goes, I pick a point that I'm focused on. There's a second point, and the rest of it just kind of comes as it goes. And that's what I do.
Yeah.
You know, there is a little formula, but you're not trying to control everything too much, because then it just becomes nothing. You know, it just becomes boring. So
yeah, I think there's two different things in there that you said that are super important. Is I think people want to be kind of backstage in your life where you're going, you know, and I think the tendency is to let people too far backstage, right? Is I don't really care what someone had for breakfast, or, you know, that their kid got on a roll. And I know it sounds super shitty, but when you're following like the greatest 1,000 artists in the world, like your breakfast really spoiled my feed. And, but you do want to allow people back, even if it doesn't get like the likes or the love or like, you see dudes like Chet Czar, who I adore. He works so hard every day.
Yeah.
And you can see the progressions.
Yeah.
His backstage, he's in front of his easel. Right.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where it is. And that, and it's brilliant, because by the time I've been watching him develop the thing all week, I'm emotionally and personally attached to it by the time it's done. Mm-hmm. I'm probably not like everybody else. I probably don't even like the finished one at the end. Cause I know it. It's like ingrained in my, you know, system at that point.
Yeah.
So I like following the in progress. I think the two get muddied, you know, with how far back you're taking somebody backstage.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, that's for art. I couldn't speak to other stuff.
No, it's true. Chet is an amazing artist and a sweetheart. That dude's really nice.
I met him. Too nice. He should be more of a dick.
Yeah. Yeah. He's like a big teddy bear. And it's like, well, first time I met him, he was just like, hey, how's it going? I was like, but
it's funny because he's a machine. Like,
oh, yeah.
You wouldn't think that you wouldn't, cause his personality is he's so fluffy.
Oh yeah.
Right. Yeah, and you fall in love with them immediately. Everybody does the first time they meet you. They're like, that dude fucking rules. But if you're watching what he's doing at home, he's spitting them out. Mm-hmm. He's firing on all cylinders all the time, and that's awesome. There's a lot of people that like get fried, you know, like I do too. You know, I get burnt out after 2-3 hard weeks of painting. I get my brain turns to mush, you know.
Yeah.
And like, I've been locked in the studio for so many days at a time. Like, the UPS guy shows up and I'm like, hey buddy, how's it going? And I'm like, why am I being so overly friendly? Oh, I haven't seen another human being in 12 hours. Maybe that's why.
Well, you're right. Cause the whole idea of that, some artists and painters, especially cause I've used this as an analogy for artists, tattoo artists and comic book store workers.
Yeah.
Is like, you have the most introverted people for the most part, not all, but for the most part. And you put them in a position where all of a sudden they're interesting, or they have a position of power or whatever it may be. And right. They're in the limelight, and you either get one or two people, one who you just has no social skills whatsoever and is just awkward, or two, one that's just a douche, you know, and it's so true. But I do agree. Like, after you're working on something so long, whether it be painting, music, whatever, for anyone out there, there gets to be a point where there is always someone push. I mean, for me, I always look at it when I'm just frustrated with something and I'm like, oh, I don't even want to sketch or draw anymore. And I look over at my coworkers, and my coworkers at the tattoo shop, they're one of them, the one that works right next to me, is just popping them out left and right, sketching hours on end, doesn't worry about it, doesn't think twice. And for me, it's a little bit more of a like, okay, you know what? You got a little bit more in you. You got a little bit more in you. Because, I mean, all said, well and done, no matter how much, you know, things have changed because of Instagram, you're always opening your phone. You're always looking at something, and there's something there to inspire you. You know, I don't go and I don't follow anybody on Instagram. And I know it sounds dickish to some people, but there are a lot of people who are like, oh man, you know, you're really cool. I like your podcast, bro. Or, oh, hey dude, I met you once. You're really cool. You're not that fat. And I'm like, oh, thanks. But
Well, you're not from this video.
Oh, thanks. But no, but like,
you get all giggly.
I'm like, hee hee hee. Tee hee. Greg O'Brien.
I think something that you're talking about, which is like super important, because I had a buddy, you know, he's working super hard at his day job, and he always, every time I saw him, he was like, man, I'm thinking about my work all the time. I wish I could paint as much as you. I'm just never getting enough done. And it's like, dude, when you're not painting, you can still be painting.
Of course.
And that might sound crazy, but like, if you're sitting there with your kids, you can stick it up on the wall and look at it. if you're sitting there, you know, next to the television, stick it next to the television, right? But you can constantly be thinking about it, working on it, and doing it even when you're not physically making it happen.
Right.
Is that what's the next thing you're going to make? And you can kind of refine those ideas, let them ferment, let them come to fruition. If you're even if you make one painting a year, you could still be technically a full-time painter if you're trying to zero it out. I think there's some kind of meridian where you're going to actually have to do some work, but
no, you're right, because you think about it. If you're sitting down watching Netflix doing nothing, thinking about how much you're trying to get better, you could be just getting better. You know, the thing I always think about, going back to the whole following thing, is there are very nice people who give comments and so forth, but I won't follow back in 100 years, and it has nothing to do with them personally. It's that, you know, every time, if I'm going to use Instagram, if I'm going to use a social media platform, I'm going to follow people that inspire me. Of course, a few friends, of course, people that, you know, I've met through business or whatever, but every time I open up my phone, there are a specific amount of artists that I really look up to. And I'm thinking, okay, I got to do better, because I am one of those people that the second I get a little leeway, I'm like, yeah, I could just, it's okay like that. But like you said, you're sitting there and you're staring at the painting after a while, you know, and you're like, shit, I could be doing this, I could be doing that, man, that needs to be rounded out more. Yeah. And all of a sudden it pushes you. And that's what works for me. That doesn't work for everybody. But, you know, like you said, there are some people who do genuinely feel like, well, I can only paint an hour out of the day, I wish I could have all this time. Well, then if you have that hour, use that hour, like every minute fucking counts. You should be thrilled.
That hour is fucking gold.
Exactly, you know? Exactly.
You get an hour. That's amazing.
Yeah, some people don't get nothing. Yeah, some people get nothing. You know, if you're at a job, if you're at a desk job and you have your lunch, take a notepad, you know, take a piece of charcoal, take something, you know, just if you got that time, use it wisely. The thing I personally don't associate with, or try to at least, is when people say, oh, I wish I woulda, coulda, shoulda kind of thing. Because if you're always wishing that something's going to get better, but you do nothing about it, it's never going to happen. You know, I can't look at your painting and be like, you know what, I wish I could paint like Cam. It'll happen one day and then break off into a Disney song. It's not going to do anything. You know what I mean? Montages don't exist, unfortunately.
Yeah, I guess not.
So
I agree. I don't know what you're trying to say. I totally agree.
So let's kind of go to the whole painting thing, man. So with your paintings, you put not only a lot of time into the painting itself, but you do a lot of like hard work into your frames, into the whole process. Like you really are a hands-on person when it comes to your art.
Yeah, you know, it's I feel like a lot of times that part of the work isn't considered, is that when I went and saw it in a building, they didn't consider it's like a last minute thing. It's like, well, it's got to go on the wall in some context or whatever, so they slap a frame on it that they picked up at a Hobby Lobby or at Aaron Brothers. And sometimes it gets a coat of spray paint, sometimes it doesn't. And like, that's the end of the story. And you technically could ruin, you know, your personal Mona Lisa by not considering that angle. When I was in college, I got severely beat up for having fancy ornate frames. And it's one of the reasons I kind of glided more towards the tattoo world, is they had more context that I liked. They seemed like more normal people, steeped in a little bit more of reality of, I have to make a living, you know, like I can't be a 90 year student trying to, you know, hack it through 80 grand with the master's school.
Right.
A lot of people don't have those opportunities. And I feel like the framework really kind of puts the bullet in the head on when I say it's done. It really is done. Mark Ryden, the Surrealist, and there's a couple others like Victoria Reynolds. They've done some stuff where it is considered, and the whole it wouldn't be the same thing without it. And I wouldn't want to push my work to where it's like so glued to it that you couldn't pull it out. But I like having it as part of the dialogue. I'm afraid sometimes it becomes too much of the dialogue because there's not as many people doing that as I am, you know? And I feel like to me, it's just kind of ancillary. It's supposed to fill in those gaps, right? I don't like looking at just a flat rail on the side of the painting, a gallery mount. I do in like a modern art setting, but most people's homes aren't modern art settings.
Right.
You know?
Well, not my thing. Well, no, you're completely right. By the way, Greg O'Brien says hi.
Oh, Greg, what's up, buddy?
And he says,
hope you're not freezing to death.
He says he'll let you know, message him about the painting in the next few days.
Tell him I'm really sorry I sold it on Saturday.
Oh, he can hear
Don't
you.
Don't kill me. I'll make you a better, more beautiful one. I love you, Greg.
Breaking hearts and taking names.
Thanks, because, like, honestly, I was dreading emailing him because I felt so bad.
That's what I'm here for. That's literally, besides the podcast, we also do telegrams.
We had to publicly drag me through the mud.
No worries.
Greg, I'm sorry.
Well, technically, you could have just not said anything about the painting and been like, yeah, no worries.
Life is live.
Yeah, it's all good. That's how it goes. Speaking of the painting, like you said, with the frame, a guy named Tony Ramirez, you know, he says brilliant.
Thanks, Tony.
A guy named Tony Ramirez is one of the first artists I ever got to actually sit down with me and just, you know, super pumped about learning how to paint and all these other things. And we had gone to LACMA, and he had said it, you know, he goes, look at the frames, look at everything around it. And he goes, imagine it like this. And he kept putting his fingers up in the shape of a frame around it. And he goes, look through my fingers. And he goes, you see how beautiful that painting is, but you see how much better it looks with that frame. He goes, now look at this one and see how much it doesn't look good with it, or how some paintings are great with no frame. And he goes, if you're going to have a complete piece, it has to accentuate it. A frame is just as important as the painting. And people don't realize that, like tattoos, a painting, you can work 6 months on it, and it only takes one photo to fuck it up. It only takes one moment to mount it, to really get rid of the emotion you're putting behind it. And he goes, I know it doesn't seem important now. He goes, but remember, one day you're going to realize that it's 1,000 times harder to plan the frame around the painting to put on a wall than it is to actually paint the damn thing. And it's so true. Yeah. It's very true.
Yeah, most people this day and age kind of start with the frame and then put their canvas in it, you know, which is the smarter way to do it. I do agree that a lot of things shouldn't have frames at all, or quieter type frames. Sometimes, unfortunately, I've kind of painted myself into a corner. Is I got so excited and made so many massively, you know, giant. Lay this pile behind me. It's like a pile behind me. Anyway, they're getting to be out of control at a certain point, and it's become like expected. Mm-hmm. And then when I don't, what happens is people will still purchase the thing, but they'll be like, hey, can you do me a favor? When you're free. Slap some massive, you know, Louis the 14th swept Renaissance frame on it. And it's like, and it's not that I want to do it. I feel like sometimes it fucks it up. Right. Also with the skulls and the frames, if it's a painting of a skull, a lot of time people want skulls in the corners. Gets to be like a lot of skulls at a certain point.
It starts looking like the catacombs of France and the whole thing.
Speaking of that, I've started working on a catacombs themed art show.
Nice.
But it's kind of a lot of work. I'm finding out the hard way. Because instead of making a painting with a skull or two in it, it's like a painting of like a skull or 400 in it. It's taking a little bit longer than I anticipated, but it's really kind of exciting. It's like climbing a mountain, and I'm kind of in the middle of it, which is pretty cool. Well, I have no idea when that would ever be done.
How long does it actually take you to paint like an average, let's just say like an average size, like behind you, the one right above your head, which I'm assuming is like what, like an 18 by 24 in the black frame?
Yeah, sure. 18 by 24 probably take me like 5 or 6 days. And that's maybe a little slow, but I use like a liquid, like a speed dryer in the paint. So the next day I go back after I've been working on it all day it's kind of ready to go again on another pass. So that seems fast for most people, but when you paint 10 hours a day, like then you dump 50, 60 hours into the thing. I hope you're getting close to done at that point for that size. So
there's some people that you see, I think it was one of Dobsky's pieces, and you know, they were asking him how long it took him to paint the Fools in the Ship or something like that. I forget the name of it. Cassin had named it, but he said, you know, it's like, well, it could take me up from 6 months. It could take me a year. He goes, it just depends on how much I want to put into it. You know, he goes, I can paint. Right. He goes, I can paint fast. I can paint slow. But once you start painting enough, you start realizing, do I want to paint efficiently or do I want to paint quickly? You know, and I do feel that starts coming into how your process works, because looking at your work, you do have such a unique style of bringing that luminance to a focal point. You know, you see the entire piece in general. And the cool thing is, like, I have all your photos here that you sent me to do for the live cast. And every single one, I remember Sean Barber at a expo, and I was painting at the World of Pencils booth. This was probably 2-3 years ago. And he was right behind me with Franco Vescovi and BJ Betts. And I looked behind me and I was like, oh, how's it going, guys? Like, you know, real nervous. And Sean just really, like, firmly but politely goes, what are you doing with the back? What are you doing with the background? And I was like, any suggestions? And he said it like in the best way he possibly could, but he goes, it's not my fucking painting. Like, straight up. He's like, what are you doing with it? And I said, I don't know. He goes, you use a lot of black in your background. He goes, you probably want to stay away from that, man. You got a lot of stuff going on. So you maybe want to use that to your advantage. In context to your paintings, you use a tremendous amount of black, but it accentuates it so well, you know.
Yeah, I don't think Sean likes my work that much.
He's an interesting guy.
I do think doing backgrounds kind of separates the men from the boys in a lot of ways. Is it gives the painting context, which is super important to try to tell the story that you're trying to tell. A lot of times when I'm doing stuff, I don't want to tell too much of the story, if that makes sense.
Right.
And I like an oppressive amount of black. There's a reason that some of them have just massive black backgrounds. I enjoy the depth and the richness of the color, especially if you mix. Like, I think part of the problem, too, is a lot of people, when they're doing a black background, is they get the tube and they just use out-of-the-tube paint, and you don't, like, mix the black into, like, this luxuriously rich, you know, Rembrandt looking, you know, inky black background. Mm-hmm. And that itself is an extremely powerful tool. I think you could say a lot with it very sharply. My artwork has a tendency to kind of like hit you in the head with a sledgehammer. I'm trying to work on being a little bit more subtle with things. That's why I'm having fun with the light. But even then, sometimes I bend it too far and it makes it too contrast too bad. You know, I'm enjoying how that looks now, but I don't know if I'm going to keep that style for forever. I don't even know if it's a style. It's just, I feel like I'm kind of just working out ideas mm-hmm. of what I like things to look like, you know, currently.
Do you think, are you afraid, I should say, of being pigeonholed into that kind of thing? Because Blake Newbert was talking about how he does the scrape paintings, you know? And I genuinely love his work. I like the look, the feel of it. And there's some of them that he has that have a little more of the 50s kind of not 50s, but I should say the why am I forgetting the name? So much for a host, right? Whatever. The old illustrations you see for Coca-Cola and God damn.
Oh yeah.
Anyways,
that Americana, like. What's his name?
This is where I'm at right now. God damn it.
There's only like 100 people online screaming. You yeah. know?
You piece it's of shit. Brushes of doom. You piece of shit. But yeah, anyways, the biggest thing is, like, you know, I would see something he's doing in that style and doing the scrape away. And he's like, you know, I'm just feeling the waters. I'm feeling something that's making me happy right now, but this was probably not what I'm always going to do. You know, I don't always want to be the scrape painting guy,
right?
You know, and he talked about being pigeonholed. Do you feel that with some of your work that you're not afraid, but like, do you ever feel like that may be something that you don't want to always be known for the skull guy or the dramatic lighting? Like, you're just trying to figure it out.
I honestly, like, I don't really care. Like, so like, if people want to see things that way, like, cool, you know, I feel like I'm me and I'm going to make what I want to make. And this is kind of what I want to make now. Now saying that's nice, but there's a certain point where people have demands and you kind of want to meet those demands if you want to eat, you know, which I totally get, but I feel like if there's something I wanted to do that was out of my abilities, I would sit there and try to get my abilities to be where it should be. So whether it's like, oh, well, I really liked all the heavy framework you were doing, well, that was then, and this is now. So get on board the new thing. Like last year, I was concerned. Last year, I did an art show in the Hamptons where everything was framed in white, whereas previous everything was framed in black. Which doesn't sound like that big of a deal, but when you're in an entire room of heavy, massively sculptural frames, I don't know if anybody would go for it, you know. And I think I kind of wrote a lot on it, but. That's how I wanted it to look. So, I mean, it turned out people liked it and I'm glad they did. And I loved it, but, I don't know. I feel like I kind of do what I'm into. It's a great place to be. I mean, I saw my friend Kit complaining online the other day, like a lot of artists got to make work to make a living. And, I was like, well, I got to make a ton of work to make a living. But I know what she was talking about. What she's talking about is certain things people know that they'll sell, so they stick with them.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing.
Right.
I think that could be a good thing in a lot of ways too. It just kind of depends on how you perceive it, not how everybody else perceives it.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Well, you're talking about Kit King, correct?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. So like Kit King.
Is there another Kit that even matters?
Well, for anyone that doesn't know, but like for Kit, just like a Space Wolf. I don't know if you've ever heard of him, but Space Wolf is a wood engraver. Does beautiful, beautiful ink work, but he laser engraves in the wood, and they both kind of had that same argument. But the idea of where Space Wolf's idea was. Some people usually break into art by doing what's popular. You know, right now, Marvel and comic books are the biggest thing in the world. So let me do a bunch of pop culture stuff and that'll get me the people that like me and I can finally do what I want. As to where Kit's like, you know, some people just do it to make a living. But as well as I agree with both of their with their points of view, because I understand where they're coming from, like you're saying, I also believe that some people just like to have fun. Some people don't care for having to tell some crazy story. You know, people just want to do art, you know? I'll draw Batman a thousand times, and I don't care what it says.
There's a blurry line, I think, when a non-trained artist is looking at work where it's like, it's hard to differentiate fan art from, you know, a little bit more streamlined work.
Of course.
It's hard to differentiate formative work from finished work or studies from actual, you know, final pieces. I think there's and some people don't see it that way either. Like, I'm not saying there's some kind of hierarchy. I'm just saying each one's got it is different and they get kind of mashed together in a real way.
Mm-hmm.
on someone's feet. It's like, wow, that's the most gorgeous picture of Ian McKellen I've ever seen. and it's like, okay, like, yeah, but I mean, it only speaks to me in the fact that I love Ian McKellen.
Right.
Other than that, it's not going to say too much past that. It's like, you're brilliantly talented, but, and fan art has a nasty way of doing that. You know, like if, I wanted to paint Ian McKellen, I'd probably just go do it. But if I want to make it as like a finished piece with something to say, mm-hmm. I would probably try to attempt to
deviate from the original source,
get him in the studio and photograph him and then paint him.
Right.
You know? And I feel like there's a division there that isn't really seen like that clearly. If that makes sense.
No, it does.
And I think a lot of photographers hit that wall pretty hard. And I think, you know, that sucks pretty bad.
Yeah. Well, you hear a lot of people, especially in the, I guess you could say on the outer limits of art, where they look at art from a non-artist point of view, and they say, well, if you can take a photo of it, why don't you just take a photo rather than paint it? You know, why don't you just do this, or why don't you just do that? And you hear these things going back and forth. I think whatever way you choose, you know, I always try to remind myself of, like, if I'm going to do a concept, if I'm going to try to study or paint something, the number one rule in my head is, not because it's my work, but just the discipline that I have to put myself through, I always think, okay, if you were to see this in a gallery, if you were to see this somewhere else, would you buy it? Would you collect it for yourself? And if I say personally no, then I'm not doing it right. And that's because for me, I don't want to put myself in that position where I'm painting something because it just looks cool for the moment being, or it's something I'm in the mood for. If I'm really trying to work on something, would I go out of my way to purchase this or to admire it? If no, then I need to work harder.
So like, and I'm completely guilty of this, and it shouldn't be this way, but it is. It's like, I feel like if it didn't sell, then it wasn't valid enough because I need that thing to bankroll the next thing, right? Mm. And a lot of working artists feel that way mm-hmm. regularly. The difference between selling something and validation, it does kind of suck, but there is, I hate to say it, there's a slight reality to that.
Oh yeah.
When I was in art school, there were people that would tell me that, like, you should never make art as a commodity. And I remember being so mad about that statement because it was like, fuck you. You know, I paid a lot of money to be here. Mm-hmm. I'm going to have to pay a lot of money and suffer in the future walking out of here. It's not like I'm leaving this place with a handful of cash and clients, you know. And that was one of the nasty things about art school, is they showed me how to make some art, but they didn't show me how to survive. They didn't show me how to varnish work, frame work, ship work, show work, portfolio. Like, they said, you know, they kind of screw people. It's almost like this terrible system where if people ask us, like, take 100 workshops, dude, and, you know, and ask the right questions. Yeah. And if you really want it, you can do it. But there's definitely is like validating something in those pantheons are very different than having something validated in the real world. You know, if you want someone to take you seriously and they don't think you are worth taking seriously, then hire someone who's going to tell them that you should take you seriously.
Yeah.
You know, is all those things can be achieved. It's just kind of like, there's no playbook how to do it. There's just a mold, and you just got to break out of it immediately.
Yeah.
You
know? The whole thing of, like, everyone has a, or what is it, like, opinions are like assholes. Everyone has one. And
I'm not coming to make out with you. I'm plugging.
Oh, no. Right. Shucks.
Back.
Get away. No, but you're right, because it's subjective to the artist and the person and themselves, because when I put myself under that thing of, like, okay, would I purchase it or buy it? It's for my own good. It's for nothing else towards anyone else, because I personally know that my biggest weak point is I can do a figure. I have no problem doing the figure. I can give the figure movement. I can give the figure emotion. I can't tie that figure in with anything else. That's my personal quip. So I work on that. I do believe that when you, like how you said, there are some people where they're like, well, art has to be this way, or art has to be that way. Art doesn't have to be a damn thing. It's very subjective. I mean, if art wasn't as subjective as it actually is, we wouldn't have people sticking cubes in the middle of the room, or somebody
painting. That's why that stuff's so cool.
Yes, exactly.
They can get away with it.
They can get away with it. You know, if there really was rules as people say, like, you're right. I have a really great friend. He's like a brother to myself, and goes to an art institute. You know, and the dude genuinely is an amazing artist. They're teaching him skills. They're giving him a piece of paper. But even he said it when he was like, I asked him, I go, well, you know, I would always love to go to an art school to learn. I mean, I've never had formal education. I try to read. I try to read as much as I can, so I can also keep up conversations with people, as well as on top of actually painting and sketching. But he says, you know what? The shitty thing is, you could go, like you said, to a seminar, and you could ask people who are legitimately doing it. You know, there's a big difference. Well,
You're absolutely right. Like, there's a lot of failed professors in college that are teaching people what they know. And a lot of what they know is not living in the real world. Like, how do you price a modern art painting? I have no fucking clue. You know, it's like, well, what does my publicist value it at? That is not a problem I have. You know, so it's like those things are also part of the job.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's not just making work.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's a dead entertainment form. I hate to say that, but they're not the rock stars of 15th century Italy. You know, like it's a hard endeavor to try to make a living at. It's hard for everybody, you know. You get a little bit let down too when you see like somebody that you've idolized and they show up and it's like, oh man, if that dude showed up in any other car that wasn't an actual spaceship, like I'm gonna be let down, you know, because that guy's the bar for me,
right?
You know? And it's hard. I think a lot of it too is being happy. Is if you're able to be an artist and be happy, you don't have to just be an artist. You know, you can be anything and still be an artist.
Oh yeah, some people.
There's a lot of misery out there.
Oh yeah, there's some people that genuinely believe that you have to do art and just art. I mean, art is like one of 10 things I do. Like honestly, if I were to have a pizza, I mean, form fitting, I guess. But if I were to have a pizza cut out, it would be like a tenth of that entire pizza because,
right.
You know, I get bored with art. I get bored with painting. I get bored with sketching. And I go and do something else, but the only reason why I get bored with it is because I genuinely am frustrated of working on something for a long time, and I go to something else, and I'm like, oh, you know what? I've stepped away for a second, and I go back to it with a fresh palette or a fresh set of ideas, you know? And I think some people feel that if you don't just bleed art, you know, like, oh, you know, I wake up and I gotta paint. If I'm in the shower, I'm drawing with, you know, soap on the walls. Like if they're not doing that, then they're definitely not an artist. You know, you can do whatever you want. There's literally, I mean, what you do as your process is 1,000 times different probably from what I do, from what someone else does. And whatever works for you works, you know?
Right. I think there's a lot of kind of a misconstrued idea of what it actually is like to try to make a living off of it. It's a very feast or famine lifestyle, as most pros know. I think the longer you do it, the less famine there is because you get a little bit better at insulating yourself. But in painting, there's not a lot of walk-ins in painting.
No.
You know, you don't really have that support system. So if that's the one thing you're going to do, you better be intelligent and ready to suffer.
It's true. No, you're definitely right. I mean, you hear people also, you hear people like, oh, I can't even get into a gallery. How would I even do this? How would I even do that? There are many galleries I've seen and been to where I look at the art on the walls. And like I said, it's not to be a dick, but I'm like, Jesus Christ, man. It's not even a cube in a room. It's literally like a bad drawing that it looks like a six-year-old did. And the idea is when you're talking to some people who are always like Debbie Downers, you know, you tell them like, well, that person, no matter where their artistic ability is at, they went out and they found a gallery that's willing to show them. And they're out there. Like you said, you're not going to get a walk-in. I mean, it's different with Instagram these days. You find people who are like taking commissions and so forth. So there is that gray area. But there is very much more where you're going to meet a lot more people in a physical setting than you ever will in a virtual setting that can help and encourage your business if you have that ambition.
Well, also too, it kind of depends if your work is made more for that setting or not.
Mm-hmm.
Like kind of back to that intent content is if you've made it to be on a wall somewhere, then you probably should stick it on a wall. But if you've made it for it to be like insta dope, then who gives a shit if you stuck it in a gallery?
Yeah.
Like you did what you designed it to do or didn't, you know, but
no,
it doesn't like have to go. It doesn't have to go beyond what you wanted it to, you know?
Yeah, no, it's totally correct because I know at least 3 or 4 artists that they paint in their room. Okay. They paint, they take all their photographs with their phone, they sell and they make a living in their studio. That's how they do it.
I take a bunch of photographs on my phone too. I'm not, you know, solely, you know, the sterile situation is I would say I'm 50-50 at this stage, where sometimes my phone I just prefer because I'm relaxed.
Yeah.
And I don't feel like I have a whole heavy – a lot of times, too, there's a lot of weight in some of those big old cannons. is that, like, I kind of just don't want to deal with it, you know, and I kind of want to get in close, which is probably so unprofessional. I'm going to hear how unprofessional it is, but I don't care.
Like you said, you're relaxed, and I think that's what matters more because – all my photos are taken with my iPhone. I have three very nice expensive cameras and lenses for photo and video work that I do for my own website. I never really I tried one time, I should say, to take a photo, and I was like, it's whatever. You know what I mean? Like it just is what it is.
Now, before I go too far deep into that, when I'm shooting a model in a whole setting.
You're not going to use an iPhone.
Like, there's no fucking iPhone in that. Like,
that's also kind of creepy when you show up.
It's like soft boxes and cables everywhere, and I got monitors and makeup and costume people and all the whole thing. You know, like I wish I could just pull out my phone and done. Mm-hmm. But there is another side. I think to say you can get a my problem is if we go off on a tangent where it's like, oh, use your phone. Who gives a shit? If you can't do the other side too,
right?
You're going to be missing a whole dimension to like the possibilities. Like, I think reference photography can be super important, and it can be super debilitating too. Mm-hmm. I think that, you know, drawing from life or, you know, looking at looking at the item and being able to do it exact, or close to it is a skill that a lot of people let drop because they want to be successful online and they want to be able to be fast. They'll pull out their tracing machine and zip through tiny little things. Mm-hmm. And if you start losing those things like big setups, and you start losing those things like, you know, live drawing abilities and things like that, you're becoming kind of one note. So you're becoming like more of a kitsch artist where you're known for doing a certain thing, where I think most artists should be good at multiple facets of, even though that's not where they make money, they should be creative in multiple realms.
Yeah, no, you're completely right. I mean, it's easy to disregard something as for the time, like in that moment, if you know how to do that thing, you know, because right. I'm never, ever going to take a photo of a work in progress. You know, I mean, even if it's just, I mean, as of late.
Really? I take tons.
No. I mean, with a actual camera, like a physical camera. Oh. What I'm saying, sorry, that was a long pause. No, but what I was going to say is like, I haven't physically painted in a little while. Cause you know, I'm interested in digital. I would like to study about it. You know, I'd like to do things. So I'm taking a little time, but I literally never take any photos, not even for the podcast. I do it all with this little iPhone right here. And the reason why is because I could do it with my camera, but I choose not to. Now, if I did, I have the light boxes. I have all this stuff. Now, if you're taking a photo reference, and this is for anyone else that's listening out there, do not take that in the idea of where it's like you said, you know, being the Insta-famous, where if you can do it with your phone, that's great. But no model is going to feel very confident if you're like, okay, we're ready for the photo shoot, and your phone's right in front of your face, you know, and it's kind
of
creepy.
I'm guilty of that too.
But they know what they're getting as far as like they know that you're a painter. You know, I've seen a guy ask a friend to model for him, and he was like, hey, man, could you give me some pointers? I said, yeah, sure. And he brought out this little Samsung Galaxy X S or something like that. And he had it in his hand. It's like, all right. And he's trying to get these dynamic poses by like doing yoga. He's like doing yoga poses just to get these shots. And I'm like, what are you doing?
Well, there's also another issue with that too, is that the Zeiss camera lens on the phones bows the images.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're going to do something up close, cool, but you're going to make it kind of, it's got like a touch of the fisheye. It only has so many color ratios too. So if you're going to do something in black and white, who gives a shit? But if you're going to do something in the full color spectrum,
it's not going to happen.
Like, well, you're just like, it's just dropping out, you know, and you're losing some of that info. You're losing like a lot of that info. When I'm painting, I mix all my colors. I don't have like 900 tubes of paint. Mm-hmm. I use like six. So red, yellow, blue is all the whole color wheel is mixed from those.
Right.
You know, with a couple of supports. And if I'm getting reference images that don't like that are missing some shit in them. It's gonna have a plastic monotone look to it, monochromatic look to it, that I feel like I can almost tell when people have shot something on their phone and then use it as a reference. So like, I'll look and it's like, yeah, this was pulled from a computer, this was pulled from your phone. I'm like, I've picked up the pieces. I think a lot of tattoo artists that are crossing their skill sets over have a natural tendency to rely on stock reference imagery or stock reference imagery that other people have access to.
Yeah.
And if you want to be that big, like Jamie Sheen over at Nico's place is the shit with this, is he sits there and he makes these huge sets and he photographs the shit out of it. And then he fucking blasts on a dude's arm and then things done. He's washed his hands of it.
Yeah.
Like, time for the next one. And, I'm sitting there watching him going, dude, you're the man. Like, nobody does that. Like, that's fucking awesome. And then now I'm noticing, like, there's a lot of people doing that. Like, Uguay does a ton of that. And it makes me want to get those hyper realism reference images, you know, for stuff. It's super cool.
Well, that's why it's a great thing. Like, for anyone that doesn't know, Jamie Sheen, Jamie underscore Sheen, he, like, when he did
Oh, yeah.
Well, Jamie was actually one of the first guys on my other podcast with Matt Hurtado. And I mean, just the amount of knowledge in that guy and the legit, like how genuine he is as a person is always nice. Cause when you ask him stuff, you see it, how it rolls over onto his Instagram account. You know, when he was doing the Buddha, when he's doing the oranges, when he's doing the flowers, he's there and he has, I believe, his wife, taking photos of him, excuse me. And you see it and he just gets this lighting and he focuses on what he wants to do for this vision that the person's giving them. You know, he's making their idea his own, you know, his own creation. And no one else in the world is going to have that exact image that you're going to find on Pinterest or you could find on Google. You know what I mean? He does do that. And I agree. That's
there's a million tattoo artists that do that. You know, like, like Billy Vegas does a shitload of that. Nico does a shitload of that. Mm-hmm. Like, there's so many guys that do a lot of that. I just feel like, and that's probably the old era of where people are pulling. And I don't want to talk, I'm not speaking to tattoo artists. I know nothing about tattooing. And it's none of my fucking business, right? But at the same time, when you're using reference images, I think using other people's reference images may not be the best idea. But if it's formative work, who gives a shit?
Right.
But if it's something like a finished thing, it does make a difference. It does matter, you know, I think.
Before we get going, man, we have a double day today. I want to ask you a few questions as far as your painting. What kind of paints do you use? For anyone that's wondering, we had somebody ask by the name of Jeremy S.C. Clow. He asked, what kind of paints do you use? And also wants to know, how long have you been painting?
Okay. I can't speak to how long I've been painting because I feel like I've been doing it for forever, but I kind of started when I was 22 and I sucked so bad. I was just globbing Jackson Pollock things at canvas until I was probably 27. So not exactly like that, but like it's been a minute. It's been a minute, more than 10 years. The paint I use, actually, hold it up. 1 second. All right. I like Old Holland paint. The one I prefer for white is the and I'm not sponsored. No one will sponsor me because I paint too many Satans and naked girls. So no plugs. So the one I like is the Old Holland titanium white because it seems to be the least opaque. And when you're using like real thin amounts of stuff and stripping it down with mediums, there's the logo.
Bazing.
And it's like fucked up expensive. I was watching another artist the other day. He's like, I bought a purple. I got to eat, you know, top ramen all week. And it's like, damn, I feel your pain, buddy. That's the one I like for bases like whites and problem I was having and a lot of my peers were having is the people that were kind of like the higher ups and the in charges at the time were these either a combo of failed contemporary artists that kind of couldn't hack it in that 60s post-Warhol bullshit and failed illustrators who there just wasn't enough to support families anymore in the illustrator realm, which back in the, you know, 60s through 80s, there definitely was.
Right.
So once it comes into that, they didn't necessarily have the answers I wanted. I'm saying their fail is not fair because it's not their fault. It's the world disappeared. You know, it's like when the water dries up, like there's nothing, it's not enough for everyone to eat. So only like, you know, like it's like Metallica and Iron Maiden being the last metal bands, you know, with a handful of very talented people is once people stop listening or stop going, what's left. So I would go to the right school if you can. I don't feel like I really, you know, got as much as I could have. I wish they were, I went to a state and I wish they were better. And honestly, is they didn't tell me this really important stuff. They just gave me a ton of abuse, which made me better.
We have Rachel Christian asking, when creating luminosity in your paintings, do you focus on doing it through glazing or do you gently go fat over lean?
Oh, I do a lot of glazing. I do a lot of glazing. Some fat over lean, I guess. I don't know. I like to do a nice, solid, exacting underpainting. And then when I'm mixing my colors to do paint applications before I blend them severely, is that the work is already done. So if I have a solid underpainting in, you know, brown and white, then the other side is like the high detail and the math of mixing out milliliters of color. I feel like I get a lot more natural, a lot more believable finished product. I think if you start the painting from zero and you're putting the exact, like working in the center and working out, I feel like it's never quite right for me when I do that. Mm-hmm. So I think the best way is to get some kind of roadmap and then deal with the color spectrum after. I don't think enough emphasis is taken on that. Definitely in school. But I get to, like, it seems like David Cassan's academia seems like the shit. I'm super jelly. Jelly is a key.
I haven't heard that word in a long time. Jelly.
Bringing it back. A bunch of them.
Lisa Camacho asks, freehand versus stenciling?
Okay, so I'm pragmatic about it, right? If I can freehand it, I'm going to freehand it. If the image is so big where it's starting to really grow and my eye perspective isn't going to happen, I'm going to stencil it. Like the image is going to fall apart when it's this close to my face versus across the room. So it's something larger than 18 by 24, for sure I'm stenciling it just because I would like to finish it at some point. I think a lot of artists are afraid to stencil. People are so impressed by things made by doing it by hand. And that's kind of how college teaches you and schools teach you how to paint. I don't necessarily find that right. Via Vermeer used a lens, Caravaggio used a mirror, you know, and if they're the greatest two in my opinion, the Rembrandt and Sargent too. And Sargent did use a lot of photography. Mm-hmm. So like references are good. Stenciling's fine. Don't be afraid of stenciling. But I would suggest you don't stencil everything because it's fucking lame. It's lame to be that guy, to be super in the parameters. You're being an artist, you know. You should be have the ability to be free with it.
Yeah, very true. Like we were talking earlier about the whole Karl Dobsky painting when he was on the Gentleman in the Boat. You know, a lot of people were like, I can't believe you stencil. Da, 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 and like all this stuff because it's a giant painting. But then a bunch of artists were like, you realize how long
it would take? People are going to talk shit because I cop to the stenciling thing. I've watched dudes like not cop to it their whole artistic lives. Mm-hmm. And people are like, oh, I'm so impressed. And I'm looking at the thing. I'm like, that's 12 feet tall. Fuck you. Like, we all know you did it. I've seen the tracer in your room. Like, come on, dude. Like, and there's
that's a bad signal.
It's like, it's okay. Like, if that makes you happy, it makes you a living in a dead art form, Go.
Get it. Christian Marr asks, any other mediums that you've worked in besides oil and or acrylic? I can't tell which ones you use, but I really love your work. Thanks.
You know what I'm really sad about is I took a bunch of I found a community college with a sculpture lab and I got to carve some marble and stuff like that. And it's so manly when using an air hammer, chopping off pieces of rock and a sledge. It's really cool. That's probably the weirdest I got out there. But I'm like a lot of other people. I like graphite, I like ink. Watercolor isn't for me because my mom is a watercolor artist.
Oh.
And I feel like it never has had the deep richness that I want and that I can get with oil paint.
Mm-hmm.
I don't really like acrylic that much. And I think my problem is I think the better acrylics are really spendy, and I feel they're not easy to blend. I gotta dump a ton of retarder to slow it down, and I don't want to do it. I want to blend my beautiful color and use a speed dryer to kick it into gear. So I think you can get maybe even more luminous paintings with acrylic. Honestly, I've seen some stuff where I've looked at it, like Todd Shore's work, the great surrealist Todd Shore. I've looked at some of his color and I want to fucking puke. It's almost not believable that it's acrylic. I felt like he's either the greatest liar or possibly the greatest acrylic painter of all time. Because color like that is another thing. What was the question? What other mediums do I use? I don't know.
Yeah, have you tried other mediums, I guess?
Wax. I like everything. I like everything except for pastels. Pastels get my fingers too messy, and I can always get on my clothes, and I can't explain the bright yellow.
We have two more. We have Rosanna Banana asks,
okay.
When working on a painting, what's the number one thing you listen to? I guess what's something you like to listen to?
That's funny. Okay, so I listen to to keep myself entertained, and I honestly really do paint a bajillion hours, as many hours a day as I can. I kind of start with music, but I don't listen to music all day. I maybe put in an hour of music. If I'm sculpting or making a frame, it's definitely neighbor abusive music. But I kind of I do like a lot of podcasts, honestly. and I like a lot of history stuff, whether it be documentary or YouTube. And I think a lot of artists have gotten huge into history because they're spending a million hours doing stuff. And that's the only thing with a massive amount of really interesting content.
Yeah.
You know, is and I've it's funny because a lot of artists, they've watched a lot of TV series many times. I don't know how many tattooers have watched Breaking Bad more than 10 times, but it's probably a lot of them. I like to listen to some heavy, loud shit when I start, and then I kind of peter out into more of a Danzig rockier, and then I finish somewhere around Ghost or Lana Del Rey when I'm done. And then I start, putting on the podcast where I was at.
It's like informative white noise, when you're listening to a documentary or you're listening to something. Last question is from Angel Reyes.
I really like Dan Carlin's Hardcore History. I listened to all of those. I'm the super fan. I listened to all of them 100 times. They're the worst. And I streamed them all, but I didn't send him money. So there's that. Asshole.
Angel Reyes again asks, how much should I draw per day? I try to draw a lot by day. Is there a specific way to learn to improve to draw and learn better? And how hard is the art life? I guess how much would you recommend to draw per day to improve?
When I was I used to have a really shitty job at the mall, when I was young, and I had it for a long time. And I remember all I wanted to do was make art all day. I wanted to be an artist. I wanted to make art. I wanted whatever I thought that meant. And it was after a while, after so many years, started really depressing me because I felt like I couldn't get anywhere near it. And I started doing this thing where it was okay, every day I'm going to do one thing for my art career. that I want, my dream. I'm gonna do one thing, whether it's like add a person online or practice drawing a hand or whatever it is, right? It would have to be like one thing. And I was like, and I used it as this kind of like mantra of like, okay, did I do one thing today? What was it? You know, I mean, I'm kind of a little obsessive like that. Now it's like all day long and it's fucking, you know, it's like, but can I do anything else? It's really, really, really hard when you start. And then when people start like kind of liking your work or you're making work that people like, and I think that's a big problem with artists is there's a point where you're just making it for you and you're just visually masturbating and that's fucking dope, but you can't expect your masturbation to become anything, you know, because you made it for you. You're not really speaking to another audience. You're like, you made it for you and you go, how much does everybody like this? It's like, you can't make somebody like your own shit. Right. You know, you have to see like, okay, think of yourself as a director. What am I going to say? Mm-hmm. You know, you don't got to say a lot or you can say a ton if you need to.
There you go, Angel.
I don't know. Does that the stupidest answer you've ever heard?
Never.
That's just bullshit.
No. Yeah. A dumb answer would have been.
It felt
like
real
42.
While saying it.
No. You made a good point because another way I've heard it is like, you know, a minimum of 4 hours a day. You know, if you want to improve on anything, a minimum of 4 hours. And it doesn't mean that you exactly have to hit that mark up to or under. The idea is you dedicate a specific amount of time and ability to something. Because like, you know, we were talking about earlier and you're what you said was completely right. The way I'm interpreting it is like
if I could draw and paint all day,
yeah,
I would. And then now that I can, I do.
Exactly.
So, like if you have 5 hours and you're wondering if you should put in three of them drawing, put in seven. Don't sleep.
Yeah.
Like you'll get all kinds of weird late night friends. They'll text you at 4 a.m. something real strange.
This last one's for me, man. I started doing it on the other podcast, but I'm bringing it to this one.
Cool.
Book, good recommendation and a good album recommendation for anyone that's interested in a book.
Good
whether
book.
A good book,
a good
to,
album,
and a good album to recommend.
Okay. All right. So. You're a guy. If you weren't a guy, I wouldn't recommend this book because I've completely. Okay, can I do two books?
You can do whatever you want. You're the man.
The first book would for sure, hands down, be Cormac McCartney's Blood Meridian, and it's about it's about man's altruistic love of war, right? And it's the most beautifully written book. It's by the guy who wrote The Road. I know there's a lot of people that are big fans of The Road.
I am.
This thing is like the sexiest, darkest, most violent reason to ever be alive. I love this book. Almost every line in it is like the best quote I've ever heard. The other book is like a lot darker, so it depends kind of how hardcore you want to get. But Lolita is the other book, and that's one that really is interesting because you really wrestle with Lolita. But it has the most poetically, charmingly wonderful ending in the sickest type of personality. Record, my last, you know, well, I'm going to plug my friends. My buddies in Avenged wrote a beautiful space-themed record called The Stage, which is rad. Before that, year before last, Mike Patton and Faith No More put out a new Faith No More album. And I really have a struggle with bands writing new records. It's like, dude, I like the old shit. Like, why don't I hear the fucking new one? Sometimes these dudes write like the best one in their golden years, and people don't give a shit until now that's an old one and there's nine other pieces of crap that have rolled out. Faith No More, Soul Invictus is one of those. I remember listening to it. The first one, I'm like, that's great. The second time I listened to it, I'm like, oh, I can't believe that record's that fucking good. Like, it really is that good. Rap-wise, I haven't heard a lot of rap I've liked in a minute. It's a little disappointing lately, you know. As far as stuff with guitars, those two books.
Nice. Cam, buddy, brother.
Thank you, X.
Thank you so much, brother. I appreciate the time that you have made to spend with me here. Also with everyone on Roll the Pencils. I hope to have you back soon.
Hi Juan, love you, Juan.
And if just in case anyone that's not familiar with your work, brother, could you please let them know where they can find you, your artwork, any upcoming shows, anything whatsoever for yourself?
You guys are the best. As far as plugging stuff, I'm the art director at the Danzig Music Festival in Irvine coming up and Memorial Day weekend. I'm building a massive castle that you can get humans sacrificed in and suspended on cables, and it's super fucked up. So once in a while, I get to do something that's not painting. Mm-hmm. As far as painting stuff, I'm working on an art show now for hopefully as soon as I can do it, but it's just like a bajillion hours of skulls. So if you like fucking skulls, I got more coming.
Nice.
How's that?
Perfect, right, man. If you want to find Cam, you can find him at Cam Rackham. On Instagram. You have your website, correct?
No, I got rid of it. I'm under the belief that no one gives a shit about my website, so I stopped paying it. Some Chinese lotion company stole it, and they want thousands of dollars to get it back, and now I'm all mad that I got super arrogant. But you know, I got social media.
Yeah,
you know, and I got like a web store that's connected to all my social media, and I ship stuff every day and whatever. You buy stuff, I have stuff. But like, as far as following me, I'm in the ether.
There you go. The best way to find Cam, in case, you do want to find him in that ether, you can find him at World of Pencils on Instagram. You can find him on the website. For everyone else out there, if you're interested in more of the episodes, you're welcome to come back next week. You can find us on Stitcher. You can find us on, hopefully soon, SoundCloud, iTunes, right underneath, World of Pencils podcast. You can find more artists just like Cam, the amazing man, on here. And don't forget to hit the like and subscribe button on YouTube. And we will see you guys here next week. Later.
See you, one.